The West, now in its third year of a historic drought, according to the U.S. Drought Monitor, 95% of the region facing abnormally dry conditions.
The western United States is entering dangerous territory. Afflicted by a megadrought so severe, it is the driest two decades in at least 1,200 years.
Reservoir levels have plummeted. We've seen worsening wildfires in states like California, Arizona, and Oregon.
And with climate change, these extremes are going to continue.
And the problem isn't isolated to just the U.S. Globally, the United Nations predicts a 40% shortfall in freshwater resources by 2030.
We're seeing a third of our arable land has been lost in just 40 years. 21 out of our top 30-something aquifers are now at critical levels.
No sector has felt the impact more than agriculture, which takes up 70% of the world's fresh water.
Irrigation is by far the biggest user of water here in California.
Agriculture is notorious for using a large amount of the state's water.
California is the largest agricultural state in the U.S. It produces foods that we cannot shift to other parts of the country or the world because of the unique Mediterranean climate.
Devin Wright experienced firsthand the challenges of the water crisis. When he planted an 80-tree orchard on his property, he quickly depleted his groundwater supply.
I was trying to manually irrigate my crop and sometimes just make mistakes and leave my water running. I'd run my well dry and very quickly realize, like, wow, you can't make a mistake when you're irrigating or else you could quickly run out your water. And that kind of woke me up to the bigger issue. Well, this is happening everywhere.
But improvements in irrigation efficiency and the integration of technology could help turn the tide in managing an increasingly scarce resource.
Growers are preparing themselves for a new type of agriculture.
Ag and tech are going to go hand in hand going forward.
The current drought started in 2020 and has quickly escalated to one of the worst in recent history.
The American West is currently in a mega drought. Scientists estimate that it's going to become worse over the course of the next few years.
Climate change has exacerbated drought conditions in places like California, Nevada, and Arizona.
The current drought has caused a tremendous amount of damage, especially to the Colorado River. Water levels in the Colorado River have neared their lowest point ever.
The Colorado River is a major water resource depended on by the Southwest, supplying 40 million people across 7 states and Mexico.
The Colorado River has essentially been a lifeline for the Southwest, and it's been critical throughout history for agriculture, for development, and for sustaining human life.
But reduced snowpack in the Rockies has caused levels to drop, severely impacting reservoirs at Lake Mead and Lake Powell.
Since 2000, we can clearly see the impacts of that in the diminishing storage in Lakes Mead and Lake Powell. And those are the two largest reservoirs in the United States. Both of them are now at record lows.
As the decline in water supply continues, the shortages and forced cutbacks across states that we saw for the first time last year are only going to increase.
The impact of these cuts is not isolated to just the West. Dwindling water supply could have devastating consequences for the nation's food security.
A prolonged drought in the U.S. will not just reduce the income of local farms in Arizona, but it's going to create much tighter supply and increased food prices, potentially for consumers across the country.
In California, drought is a normal part of its climate, but trends show it is becoming more frequent and for longer stretches of time. The state has started to take some measures to reduce water usage. In July 2021, Governor Newsom asked residents to voluntarily reduce usage by 15%, and in Southern California, outdoor watering bans have gone into effect. And while these conservation efforts could be helpful, it is unlikely to move the needle in a meaningful way.
In normal water years, agriculture and the environment use roughly equal amounts of water, and urban is a lot less, being down in the 10 to 15% range.
So when you're told to take a quicker shower or not wash your car, honestly, these are rounding errors just to the amount of water that's used in food production. And the absolute worst offenders are kind of old school irrigation techniques of flooding systems.
For centuries, farmers have relied predominantly on flood irrigation. This is the most wasteful in terms of water usage. However, in recent years, farmers have started adopting more efficient methods.
Sprinkler irrigation has increased significantly And what's even more interesting is the growth in micro-irrigation, which was almost 0% in the mid-70s, and it's now almost 10%.
Micro-irrigation systems such as drip and micro-sprinklers are some of the most efficient methods available today.
With flood irrigation, you can only irrigate maybe once or twice every 2 weeks. But with micro-irrigation, you can irrigate every day. You can inject the fertilizers in your irrigation water. You keep the water away from the plants, and so you minimize diseases. And so they figured they could produce higher yields on less than 20 or 30% less water than they used to do.
In some places, the adoption of these systems has been strong.
Tomatoes used to be predominantly flood irrigated. They're now close to 90% subsurface drip irrigation.
But drip irrigation systems are expensive, often costing upwards of $3,000 per acre. Instead, many farmers have opted for more affordable sprinkler systems.
The most popular method now in the U.S., which is over 50% or around 50%, is sprinkler irrigation, specifically center pivot irrigation. And the investment for the farmer is much lower per unit of land.
For farmers, water management has always been a challenge. The impact of recent droughts have only made things worse.
I was in Arizona this year, and I met with several farmers. I was driving through farming communities outside of Phoenix and was seeing miles of unplanted land and dried up canals and dead cotton fields. It was a very desperate situation, and it's been heartbreaking for farmers whose families have farmed this Arizona desert land for generations.
In the last couple of droughts, we've seen about, rough number, 500,000 acres of land fallowing, and that's in the context of irrigated acreage in California being a little less than 9 million acres.
A lot of farmers in Arizona facing water cuts have fallowed their land. Some farmers have switched to less water-intensive crops because farming in Arizona is very water-intensive. And other farmers are actually trying to pump more groundwater, which is a controversial practice.
During previous droughts, many turned to groundwater as a crutch to lean on.
When we had these multi-year droughts, what farmers would do would, you know, if they got zero allocation surface water, they would drill a well. Groundwater was sort of an insurance policy that they would go to.
But over-reliance on slowly replenished underground aquifers have created a whole new set of problems.
Places like Central Valley, the Salad Bowl of the United States, sunk 28 feet because of our overuse of groundwater.
Then, of course, you have breakdown in infrastructure, canals starts to collapse, bridges collapse, roads collapse.
With little alternatives for more water, the focus has intensified in better managing the resources we do have. Several are working to tackle the water use efficiency issue with more advanced irrigation systems. U.S.-based Jane builds and manages smart irrigation systems on farms. An Israeli company, Netafim, which invented modern drip irrigation technology, is developing even more efficient drip systems. And one startup is hoping to make a difference by merging the Internet of Things with drip irrigation.
Lumo is a series of internet-connected smart valves. And the system gives growers easy access to irrigation automation, tracking, and reporting so they can quickly and easily access precision irrigation. Most important thing is they can automate those valves. Today, a lot of farmers are out there turning them on and off manually. That saves them a lot of cost, and it also allows them to be very precise about the amount of water that they're distributing. It is powered first and foremost by a battery and solar. It has a computer inside that is connected to a valve as well as some sensors, think like a flow meter. They stay connected to the cloud. We can allow our farmers to access them through a mobile app or a web app. We queued up a block, so we just do that here by saying, okay, we wanna go, you know, block two. We pick 30 minutes, we queue it, but now it's got a 30 minute run. That's it. Hit the schedule. And now it's running. And these lines will all fill up. And then we're tracking that flow through here. Total remote control, which is a real big benefit. We've saved easily 30% of our water that we were using for irrigation, simply by removing some of the man-made error. We think that's really valuable to the farmer, but we also think that's going to become really valuable to other stakeholders like communities, governments, water boards, irrigation districts, because they're all asking, how much water are we using? And they don't know. They just have to estimate.
It's currently testing its second generation model with a small pilot program. One user, Kurt Beitler of Bohem Wines, has six valves to water his 6 acres.
We saw an opportunity to try some of this tech on one of my vineyard blocks, and it's really been wonderful. The biggest improvement with Lumo for my farming operation has been the convenience and precision with how we're irrigating. We've safely reduced excess use of our water by at least 20%. It might be as much as 30 or 40%.
Bohem has its system programmed to automatically irrigate at night.
We take great effort to irrigate in the nighttime, so we get greater uptake and utilization of the water by the vines.
And for specialty growers such as Beitler's Vineyard, the precision system offers greater control over the growing conditions.
With optimal use of water, we're optimizing our finished wine quality. So this is one more very valuable tool in the overall project.
Others have sought to completely reimagine how we approach farming altogether by bringing crop cultivation indoors.
We felt like we needed a more sustainable alternative, a solution that we call kind of climate adapted. And so what we do is we've developed our own kind of advanced robotic greenhouses.
IronOx, a San Francisco startup backed by Bill Gates' breakthrough energy venture, is growing leafy greens at facilities outside of Gilroy, California and Austin, Texas.
Gilroy, California. That's been operational for 3 years, sold out with different greens, herbs, things like that. And so the idea is that to be able to grow any crop, including we have strawberries, tomatoes, cucumbers in the pipeline, our new facility outside of Austin, Texas. And that's gonna be about 100x bigger at full scale by end of next year.
The company is utilizing robotics, plant science, and hydroponics to optimize the growing process.
With hydroponics, we're able to apply water and the exact amount of nutrients directly to the roots of the plant. And then through things like water reclamation and other parts in the future, we can actually recycle that water to use less and less water over time, even in drought-stricken states.
Square Roots is another indoor farming startup that is utilizing vertical farming. It currently has 5 commercial-scale farms across the Midwest and in New York City.
We just had to kind of reimagine how to grow plants at commercial scale in cities. Inside the farms, we have the perfect climate for growing the plants. We'll go from seed to harvest in 28 days, right, which might be almost twice as fast as what you can do in an outdoor field.
It is also using hydroponics to help minimize water waste.
A ton of research studies out there that will show that a well-tuned hydroponic system will use about 90% less water than the equivalent outdoor farm.
For now, the company is growing salads, herbs, and microgreens and selling in the local communities where it's deployed farms. It is working to expand that to include crops such as turnips, eggplants, and more. Researchers are exploring a number of projects that could also help farmers. At the University of California, Davis, Ali Pereza started a lab to research new monitoring and sensing technologies to help growers save water.
The focus of this lab is to provide data-driven decision support tools for growers when they want to make some critical decisions about how and when to irrigate or fertilize.
One of his projects is focused on analyzing crop yield, helping farmers identify areas that are underperforming.
And then we manage each zone differently. That would help us reduce waste in application of, for example, fertilizer or water or pesticide, and also to optimize the crop production.
Isaiah Kaseka oversees a group that uses computer simulation models to improve efficiencies on farms.
With these computer models, you can start to ask what-if scenarios. What if I have this amount of water, I can simulate or project how much yield I'm going to expect. As they make irrigation decisions through the season, they see what impact those irrigation decisions are going to have on their production goals.
But despite the potential impact of these new technologies, adoption is still moving slowly. Some think it could take government incentives and regulation to push more efficient conservation tools into mass adoption.
I think government can play an important role by introducing some incentives for growers that they adapt a smart farming practices and technologies.
You need policy and technology together to solve the water challenges in agriculture. Both together, I think we can go a long way.
As the industry adapts to the ongoing drought, there will be no one-size-fits-all approach.
We're not going to get to this kind of next generation of farming with an incremental solution. I think it's going to require, to be clear, multiple solutions.
I think by the end of this decade, it would be a very pretty established practice to use technology, to use some automation, to use the data in a more practical way in agriculture.
I think it's exactly this kind of technology that, in fact, will be the solution to potential water crisis or shortage of water. If farmers have access to technology that will help them better utilize the water, we could have a very significant impact as a whole on net usage in the state.